السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. Once again, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. إن شاء الله تعالى we're starting our study of سورة الكوثر in this series, and it's a pleasure to be here in Richardson this week. الحمد لله. As many of you know, we'll be doing this every first week of the month, first Tuesday of every month. The other three sessions still in the Irving Masjid, inshallah ta'ala. Part of the sort of tradition of these durus is that we take a moment in the beginning to comprehensively discuss an introduction to each surah. And because Suratul Kawthar is so heavy, it's one of the shortest surahs of Quran, and also at the same time it's a very heavy surah in terms of its content, its message, and its wisdom, most likely I will not be able to accomplish a complete dars of the surah today. We're probably going to end up exhausting ourselves in the introduction and then perhaps some discussion of the first ayah, bi-idhnillah ta'ala. So I want to begin with a really well-written introduction written by Dr. Fadl Salih Hassam al-Ra'i, who's a renowned author and scholar of Quranic studies. He writes, Suratun Makkiyah hiya min a'zami as-suwar allati tudhiru ni'am Allahi تعالى على رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم وفضله العظيم. It is a Meccan surah, and it's from the one of the greatest surahs of the Quran in which the favors of Allah are manifest upon His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and His incredible preference given to Him. In other words, this is the surah, if one is to study how does Allah show preference and honor His Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, this is one of the greatest surahs to study in that context. By no means is it the only surah, but certainly one of the greatest of them. وَعِطَائِهِ الْكَثِيرِ لَهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. And also this surah is dedicated to mentioning what Allah gave to him in abundance, not only in this world, but also in the next. In the ayah, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ, roughly translated, no doubt we have given you the abundant good. That's how it's commonly translated. But we'll take a deeper look at it later on. وَكَمَا فِي سَابِقِ السُّورِ الَّتِي فِيهَا إِخْبَارٌ بِالنِّعَمِ مِنَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى تَأْتِي نِهَايَةَ السُّورَةِ بِالدَّعْوَةِ لِلشُّكْرِ وَعِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. And this is a very important concept that he mentions. He says this is consistent with previous surahs in which Allah also mentions His favors, that those surahs also conclude with a call to either show gratitude to Allah or to do ibadah to Him. When Allah Azza wa Jal mentions His favors, then at the end He mentions that you should be grateful to Him. For example, you know the famous surah, Allah Azza wa Jal says, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًّا فَهَدَى وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. But then at the end of that surah also, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. So it's a call, an invitation made to show gratitude to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is consistent in this surah also, because in this surah there's a call to ibadah made right after the gift. إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ is the gift. And then what's the call? فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ, pray to your master. And pray only for the sake of your master. وَقَدْ خُدِمَتِ السُّورَةِ بِذَمِّ إِعْدَاءِ الرَّسُولِ. And the surah concludes with a condemnation of the enemies of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وَبَيَانِ أَنَّهُمْ هُمُ الْمَقْطُوعُونَ مِنْ كُلِّ خَيْرٍ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. And it elaborates that they are in fact the ones that are going to be cut off completely from every good in this world and the next. What ayah is he talking about? إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. He's talking about that ayah. أَمَّا الرَّسُولُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فَقَدْ أَعْلَى اللَّهُ تَعَالَى ذِكْرَهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَأَعْطَاهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. As for the messenger who is concerned, صلى الله عليه وسلم, Allah has elevated him in terms of his mention in this world and has granted him in this world and the next, مَا هُوَ أَهْلٌ لَهُ وَاسْمُهُ ذِكْرَهُ خَالِدٌ إِلَىٰ آخِرِ الزَّمَانِ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. And he is given to him what he is worthy of. And so in this surah, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in regards to his enemy, إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ لِأَنَّ الْمَعْنَى الْأَبْتَرِ الْمَقْطُوعُ مِنْ كُلِّ خَيْرٍ. That the meaning of abtar in the ayah is the one who is cut off from any form of good. There is no good at all left in this person. And inshallah ta'ala we'll see why this language is very, very strong when we get to that ayah. You know, there's the word batr. باتر also, بتير also. There's different, you know, morphological forms of that word. But this, you know, this is أفضل التفضيل in morphology. This is called انصرف. This is it's a very strong form of the noun that is used, أبتر. And there's a reason that's used, and when we get to the ayah, we'll study that, inshallah ta'ala, in more detail. In regards to the study of coherence of surahs, we study the relationship of the previous surah with the next one. And in regards to that study, there's a few observations we're going to make. Actually, I'll go straight to the commentary of Fakhruddin al-Razi, rahimahullah. في السورة المتقدمة وصف الله تعالى المنافق بأمور أربعة. He says that in the previous surah, and what's the previous surah? Surah Al-Ma'un. Allah Azza wa Jal attributes, gives us four attributes, or depicts four things about the hypocrite. Among other comments that we made in Surah Al-Ma'un, one of the things we learned about Surah Al-Ma'un is the hypocritical behavior. And he says that there were four major hypocritical acts or attitudes that were highlighted in Surah Al-Ma'un. أولها, the first one, البخل. وهو المراد من قوله يدعو اليتيم ولا يحض على طعام المسكين. The first of them is miserliness, being cheap, you know, and being, you know, greedy. And so greedy that you're willing to push the orphan around and not even talk about giving to the poor. We talked about this last week. Why Allah didn't say that he doesn't give to the poor. ولا يطعم المسكين. He didn't say that. He said ولا يحض على طعام المسكين. This is different. Doesn't even encourage. Doesn't even, you know, bring it up. Why not? Because if he brings it up and he's wealthy and he's encouraging people to give to the poor, the people are going to say, well, what about you? What are you doing? And he figures, hey, if I don't bring it up, nobody will bring it up to me, so he doesn't even, you know, talk about it to begin with. And this is the extreme state of miserliness. He will see poverty around him, and he's in a position to say something because the previous surah was talking to leaders of Quraysh. They're in a position to say something, but they're not going to open their mouth because it makes them look bad. Because people will say, well, you're the one saying it, why don't you begin with it? You should be the first to do it. Anyhow, so the first attribute of hypocrisy is al-bukhl. The second, wa-thani, tarku as-salah wa huwa al-murad min qawlihi. And the second is the abandonment of prayer. And where is that in the previous surah? Al-ladhina hum an salatihim sahun. In that ayah, Allah Azza wa Jal mentions the second attribute. Sahwa literally means to forget something when it's not that important to you. So they really abandon the prayer for things they think are more important. You know, Allah Azza wa Jal didn't say الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ تَارِكُونَ. He didn't say that they're, you know, they're tarikun, they're sahun. And sahwa again, they don't care for it. It's not a big deal. You know, لَا يُبَالِي أَمْ صَلَّى أَمْ لَمْ يُصَلِّي. It wouldn't make a difference. If he prayed or didn't pray, it wouldn't matter to him. Not a big deal. And other descriptions that we talked about last week were also waits till the very end of salat time is about to be over and then makes salat, right? Or even if he misses a salah, it's not, you know, who cares? That sort of attitude. May Allah Azza wa Jalla protect us from that attitude. والثالث, المراءات في الصلاة وهو المراد من قوله. And the third attribute, now keep in mind what's the sequence. The first one was to be cheap. And the second one was to be heedless and to abandon the prayer carelessly. And the third one now, showing off in matters of salah. Where does he say that? الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ. This is the third attribute. They're the ones who show off. When they pray, they're not praying for Allah, they're praying to show off. والرابع المنع من الزكاة وهو المراد من قوله. And the fourth is giving even the smallest acts of charity, the bare minimum acts of charity. And this is interesting. In some works of classical Islamic scholarship, they don't use the word sadaqah, they use the word zakat. And it's not just referring to the legal term zakat, the 2.5%, but they actually use it because that's the least someone is supposed to give. They would be a criminal if they didn't give that much. So that's how it's used. The least bit of charity. That's what zakat, in that context it's used. And of course what ayah talks about there, them not even being even to be willing to give even the least bit, it's وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. That ayah is talking about that final bit that they're not even willing to give, that which is mandatory upon them. Because literally the word ma'un in Arabic means the item which you're not supposed to refuse ever. It's not just money or things. It's, you know, الشيء لا يمنع منه. You know, there's something that you don't forbid someone from giving. Somebody asks you for a glass of water, you're not going to be cheap about it, right? You don't turn it away from them. But they even do that much. And this wasn't even part of the deen. This is even before Islam. The word ma'un was understood in this way. You just don't turn people away from certain things. But they would even do that much. These four attributes. Now let's see how he connects those four attributes to the contents of this surah. ذكر في هذه السورة في مقابلة تلك الصفات الأربعة صفات أربعة. He says that in comparison and contrast to these four attributes, Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions four other attributes in this surah. And let's see what they are. فَذَكَرَ فِي مُقَابَلَةِ الْبُخْلِ. And in contrast to being miserly and cheap, what did he mention in contrast in this surah? إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ. We have given you the abundant good. So the contrast of being cheap is giving. And who's giving here? Allah Azza wa Jalla. And here he adds the commentary, فَأَعْطِ أَنْتَ الْكَثِيرِ وَلَا تَبْخَلْ. He says, if Allah is giving so much, then it's only natural that you should now give more. And this is something we learned in the previous two surahs. In Surah Quraysh, Allah told us what He gave Quraysh. And when you are given a lot, then you should give a lot yourself. If you're given a lot, you should give out yourself. You see, the same thing happens with the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The Messenger himself was an orphan, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا. But now that he's taken care of, what is he supposed to do? فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ. Immediately it comes after. You know, now that he's been given, he should take care. So Surah Quraysh, Allah gave Quraysh. So what are they supposed to do? They should give now to others because they're taken care of. Their food is taken care of, summer and winter, and they're in complete safety. And their food supplies are taken care of. الَّذِي أَطْعَمَهُمْ مِنْ جُوعٍ. They've got enough to eat. So they should be ones who give. But what does the next surah tell us? الْمَعُونَ. They don't give. They don't give what they're supposed to. So by Allah saying, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ, one of the implications of that is to give. If Allah has given you so much, then the very least you should do is that you should give. وَذَكَرَ فِي مُقَابَلَةِ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عَنْ صَلَاتِهِمْ سَاهُونَ. And in contrast to mentioning, in the previous surah he mentioned the people who don't care about salah. And what does this surah say? فَصَلِّ فِعْ الْأَمْرِ. Pray then. And what is this pray? دُمْ عَلَى الصَّلَاةِ. Be constant in the prayer. When Allah commands, now don't take it carelessly. Because you know, it's not just, you know, salah is a good thing, salah has benefits. Allah is commanding to the salah. When He's commanding to it, He's expecting from us consistency. Problem? Better? Okay. Alhamdulillah. Okay. So that's the second. وَذَكَرَ فِي مُقَابَلَةِ الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ. And the third. Now remember, there were four problems he listed in the previous surah. Being cheap, and then being careless about salah, even abandoning it. The third, showing off in salah. Now he's going to talk about the third one. And in contrast to the third one, الَّذِينَ هُمْ يُرَاءُونَ, they're the ones who show off. قَوْلُهُ لِرَبِّكَ. لِرَبِّكَ. You know, in contrast to that, he says, not just pray, but pray for the sake of your master. In other words, your intention should only be for Allah Azza wa Jalla, and they should not be addressed to anybody else. So now here, this is the matter of ikhlas. As opposed to there, the problem was a lack of ikhlas. You're not doing it for Allah, you're doing it to show off. Then finally, وَذَكَرَ فِي مُقَابَلَةِ وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. And in contrast to mentioning that they forbid even the smallest favor, that they don't give what they're supposed to, Allah Azza wa Jalla here says, وَانْحَرْ. And sacrifice. First of all, sacrificing an animal requires you to spend money. Because animals aren't free, so it requires to spend money. And when you sacrifice the animal, part of the meat is supposed to be given in what? Charity. The act in and of itself includes at-tasadduq, you know. So the one who gives the sacrifice necessarily is giving sadaqah after they're done. So that's what he mentions, وَأَرَادَ بِهِ التَّصَدُّقْ بِلَحْمِ الْأَضَاحِ. That by that Allah Azza wa Jal alludes to or intends to talk about the sadaqah that is to be given from the flesh of the slaughtered animal. فَاعْتُبِرَ هَذِهِ الْمُنَاسَبَةَ الْعَجِيبَةَ. Then this strange and beautiful correlation between the two lessons of these two surahs is appreciated. Then Allah Azza wa Jal says, إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرِ. That your Allah at the end of that surah talks about the enemy. Right, the enemy of the Prophet ﷺ, who will be discontinued. And the previous surah is dedicated to the acts of the one whose mention should be discontinued from the beginning to the end. أَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي يُكَذِّبُ بِالدِّينِ فَذَلِكَ دُعُ الْيَتِيمِ. All of these descriptions are the descriptions of the person who is al-abtar. They are descriptions of it. So there's a connection between these two things. Now, this, inshallah ta'ala, what we're going further into is we're going to dedicate ourselves in appreciating just some lessons from the first ayah. And I'm not going to go in order of the words. We'll come to the words later on. I'm going to start from the word Al-Kawthar itself. Al-Kawthar itself. And Al-Kawthar, inshallah ta'ala, later on in the lesson today, we'll look at the linguistic meaning of Al-Kawthar, what it comes from, what its implications are. But for now, we'll just say it means the abundant good, the great good. The great good, al-khayr al-kathir, like many of the salaf say. And inshallah ta'ala, as we go through these notes, we're going to find why is it that Al-Kawthar includes so many things. Many of you have heard that when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, we have given you, meaning the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Al-Kawthar, you know, هو الحوض في الجنة, it's the river in paradise. Also, الحوض في الموقف, it's also the river in the place that we have to stop before we head off to paradise, meaning on the day of resurrection, the believers will have a place where they can drink, right by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's referring to two things, a bank of water available to us before we enter paradise, and even after we enter paradise. There's two of them, and they're both included in Al-Kawthar, according to several athar and narration that are found in classical works of tafsir. But we're going to begin from a different point of view. And at the end, we'll see how there is no contradiction. In the traditional narrations of classical scholars, we'll find that Al-Kawthar, describing this great good, they didn't limit it to the discussion of just the river in paradise and the river before we enter paradise, or these banks of water. There's talk of a lot of other goods. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to start with one of the most famous lists made of the goods. One of the tafaseer in this regard, for example, a tafsir al-kabir, Fakhruddin Imam Razi, what he does is he makes a list of some favors Allah has given him just in some of the previous surahs. He just makes a list of them. And I'm going to just share with you some of this list so you can appreciate what kind of reflection these ulama used to make when they studied Quran. Let's start. He says, first Allah said, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Allah Azza wa Jalla says to his messenger that he did not abandon him. He didn't say goodbye to him. Tawdi'a. You know, wida', in order to say al-wida', right? It's Arabic word. Tawdi'a. He didn't say goodbye to you, and he's not displeased. And even in that ayah, there's a gift to the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Arabic expectation is, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَاكَ. There are two, the kaf, the pronoun is expected twice. The English translation would have been, he didn't say goodbye to you, and he is not displeased with you. But with goodbye, the messenger is mentioned, but with displeasure, the messenger's name is not mentioned. And that's a gift of Allah to the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's out of love, because the word goodbye doesn't have any negative connotations, but the word displeasure clearly does, and Allah does not mention the name of his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, next to that negative word. Even in that ayah, there's a gift. And of course, the lesson of the ayah, that Allah is not going to be one to ever abandon his Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he says, وَلَلْ آخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَىٰ. Another gift to the messenger. No doubt about it, what is at the end is better for you than what is in the beginning. What an amazing gift to the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then on top of that, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ. You know, in this surah, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ. We've given you. And he describes what he's given him as Al-Kawthar. But then what does he say? وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ. He doesn't mention Al-Kawthar. He just says, no doubt about it, I swear very soon your master will give you a lot. He will give you. He will grant you. فَتَرْضَى. And how do you quantify how much will he give? You know, when you give a gift to someone, you say, I'm going to give you something. What are you going to give me? How much? What's it worth? Right? Now, how do you put a value to it? Allah Azza wa Jalla puts a value to it for his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, فَتَرْضَى. I'll give you so much that you'll be happy. You'll be pleased. So the quantity is described as, it'll be so much, and it won't stop until you say enough. Until you say, I'm pleased. And the messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, look at his love for this ummah. He said, then I won't be pleased until all of my ummah is saved from the hellfire. This is the love he has for us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah Azza wa Jal is his other favors that are part of this Al-Kawthar. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. We mentioned this ayah before. Didn't he find you an orphan and gave you shelter? وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. In that ayah, when we studied this ayah a few months ago, you know, ضَال is not translated here as lost or misguided. It's translated as seeking. Is understood as seeking. The one who can't find his way and is desperately looking. He found you in a state where you were desperately looking and he gave you guidance. What bigger gift than that? Then, وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. And he found you in desperate financial need and he made you free of need. Then he says, أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكَ sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Didn't we open your chest for you? And what an opening of the chest that the Qur'an can fit in it. The Qur'an that wouldn't fit inside a mountain, right, and it would explode. That Quran fits in the heart of the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in addition, the pressure one would feel that when the ayat would be revealed, we know the narrations. Camels, if he was sitting on a camel, the camel would sit down. It would sink into the sand. You know, the Sahabi's knee, the Messenger's knee is on top of the Sahabi's knee one time, right? And the ayat start coming down, and the Sahabi narrates, "I felt like my knee was about to shatter." Allah says, "Inna sanulqi alayka qawlan thaqila." We're going to make you come into contact with a very heavy word. And it was literally heavy when revelation used to come. But the messenger's chest is open so he can receive it. What an amazing gift. It's part of al-khayr al-kathir. Then, وَوَضَعْنَا عَنْكَ وِزْرَكَ. We removed your burden from you. الَّذِي أَنْقَضَ ظَهْرَكَ. The one that was breaking your back. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. What a gift of Allah here. We elevated your mention for you. You know, and this رفع is, it's understood in two ways. You know, there's, in Arabic you can, and like in any other language, you can look at something literally and figuratively, right? So when you say, we elevated his mention, it means بصوت, meaning we made his mention go out loud, and that's actually true in every adhan that happens across the world. Not a minute goes by that somebody's not reciting أشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه, and everybody who hears it says صلى الله عليه وسلم, and it's being elevated, his mention is being elevated like nobody else's. Name any other human being, any other human being that is mentioned in this way constantly, constantly. And instead of the mention going down over time, what happens? It goes up over time. It doesn't go down over time, it increases. Subhanallah. And Allah says, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. So this is, and your mention, right? And Allah Azza wa Jal gave us so many incentives in the Quran to remember and send praises upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the believer is constantly looking for opportunities to do so. Allah Himself says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِي. Allah Himself and His angels. You know, in Arabic, you don't typically mention the noun first. You mention the verb first. You know, so it's يُصَلِّ اللَّهُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ. That's the expected format. جُمْلَة فِعْلِيَة is the expected format of the sentence. There Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ. You know what that means? Imagine, even Allah, no doubt about it, Allah and His messengers, they're sending salawat upon His messenger, upon the Prophet ﷺ. Then, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا now realize, صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Right? Allah didn't just say, begin, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. They didn't begin like that. So many ayat in Quran begin with, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, just like that, straight. But before he gets to that topic, what does he come to? You better realize, what I'm telling you to do is something I do myself and my angels. How will the messengers mentioned not be elevated? وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. This is part of the good that Allah has given His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. أَنَّهُ أَقْسَمَ بِبَلَدٍ. You know, Allah mentioned, Allah swore by the city. And when Allah swears by something, one of the meanings of that is it's been honored. And one of the things Allah swore by is the city in which the Prophet is born صلى الله عليه وسلم. You know, وَهَذَا الْبَلَدِ الْأَمِينَ. He swore by that city. And by the way, Allah Azza wa Jalla swears very, very few times, you know, by anything other than some of His magnificent creations. But in the Quran, you know, that other than these other creations, there is no human being that has ever been sworn. Allah doesn't swear by another human being except the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. La umruk. Allah swears by His Messenger. I swear by your life. And the only other than these inanimate objects, you know, Allah Azza wa Jalla swears by, you know, animals, al-adiyat, horses, winds, the sky, the sun, but He also swears by Himself, His own self, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bala wa rabbika la yu'minun. You know, wa rabbik. This is Him swearing by Himself. And even when He swears by Himself, first of all, appreciate this. What's the difference between Allah swearing by a creation and then Allah swearing by Himself? Isn't there a huge difference? Even in importance, we can't imagine. First of all, when Allah swears by anything, it's important. And now He's swearing by who? Himself. And even when He swears by Himself, He doesn't just mention Himself. Next to it, He mentions His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He doesn't say وَرَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَرَبِّهِمْ. No. وَرَبِّ الْمَلَائِكَ. No. What does He say? وَرَبِّكَ يَا مُحَمَّدْ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. I swear by the your master. Even when He swears by Himself, He honors His Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. This is part of the الخير الكثير. الكوثر هو الخير الكثير. You know, that abundant good is that enormously plentiful good that has been granted to the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then He even mentions that Allah granted His Messenger so much that He even gave the rewards that He was giving him, the rewards that are given to the Messenger, وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ. وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ. You have a reward that can't even be quantified. It cannot have any breaks on it, any limits on it. This is something Allah says, especially to His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and He loves His Messenger so much, He even gave that to the believers. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ فَلَهُمْ أَجْرٌ غَيْرُ مَمْنُونَ He gave them that too, out of the love of His Messenger, as He comments, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then Allah Azza wa Jal honors His Messenger with even the beginning of revelation. Even that was an honor. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. And in that same surah, anyone who calls against the Messenger, who intimidates him, who tries to bully him, this is a reference to Abu Jahl. فَلْيَدْعُ نَادِيَةً Let him call his posse. Let him call his gang. سَنَدْعُ الزَّبَانِيَةً We'll bring in our SWAT team also. الزبانية literally means police, you know, security. And Allah says, we'll bring in our security detail. Let him call his posse. What has he got? Allah comes to the aid, the defense of His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَنَّهُ خَصَّهُ بِالْقُرْبَةِ التَّامَّةِ And Allah specified His Messenger with a special kind of closeness. A kind of closeness never given to anybody else. With what words? وَاسْجُدْ وَاقْتَرِبْ Make sajda and come close. He's specifically to the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are from the gifts Allah has given him. Then he says, Inna a'tainaka hadhihi al-manaqib. Now after quoting all these ayat, what does he say? Inna a'tainaka hadhihi al-manaqib al-mutakathira al-mathkura fi suwarihi al-mutaqaddima allati kulla wahidin minha. Now listen to this. It is as though Allah is saying, I give you all of these gifts in the surahs that have been revealed before in the Quran, or you find in these ayat in the Quran, and each and every single one of them, أعظم من ملك الدنيا بحذافيرها. It is more valuable than the entire treasures and sovereignty of the world, combined with all of its assets and its wealths. فاشتغل أنت بعبادة هذا الرب. Then you remain busy in the slavery and servitude and worship of this master. Subhanallah. That's he says. He connects this to فصل لربك وانحر. Now we come to the ayat and a little bit of a word analysis. We'll go word by word by word and look at some of the other aspects of khayr and then combine the statements of previous scholars with what we just studied under Tafsir Razi. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. A'ta yu'ti i'ta. First verb in the ayah. I'ta. There's another word in Arabic, a'ta, to give. Then there's a'ta. And a'ta is also commonly translated as to give. Then there's another word, wahaba. Wahaba, like Rabbana hablana. Sometimes we say Rabbana atina, right? We say atina, give us. And sometimes we say Rabbana hablana, grant us, give us, also giving. So there's wahab, there's ita, there's i'ta. What's the difference between these words? Hiba in Arabic, or wahaba, is to give a gift. And it's not just a small gift, it's a huge gift. So when we ask Allah to give us tranquility from our spouses and our children, then that's a big gift. That's not something small. If someone can be happy with their spouses and their children, then they're very, very fortunate. Because the vast majority of people who live in a household are not happy in the household. So when they can enjoy that's not a small gift, that's a big gift, right? So hablana min azwajina wa dhurriyatina qurrata a'yunin. This is in Surah Al-Furqan. Ita in Arabic, to give, is actually to give, but it's not absolute. In other words, you are giving something, but it comes with responsibilities, or you're giving something that you can take back. For example, تُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ Right? تُؤْتِ الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ But also, تَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ You can give it to whoever you want, and you can take it away from whoever you want. Is it possible the same one Allah gave it to, He can take it away from the same one also? Yes, it is. This is إِتَاء. Either it's something that's given that can be taken away. That's one implication. And the other, it's something that's given that comes with responsibility. For example, آتَيْنَاهُمُ الْكِتَابِ We gave them the book. Allah gave the book. Does the book come with responsibility? It does. It does. So when giving is associated with some responsibility, or it's something that can be taken back, then in these scenarios, ita is used. But i'ta, it has several implications. One of them is that, you know, in Arabic, words have root letters, and sometimes the sequence of the root letters is shuffled, and the meanings are connected. For example, shukr and shirk have, you know, contradictory meanings, but they're similar in their spelling. You know, husn and nahs have different root letters, they're sequenced differently, but they're connected in their meaning, they're contrast each other. This is a feature of classical Arabic. There's i'ta, which is, the root letters are ayn, ta, and waw. Ayn, ta, and waw. But then there's tawwa, t, ta, waw, and ayn. It's a different sequence of letters. From it, we get the word ita'a, which means to obey, to follow, right? Or to listen carefully to. You know, the word i'ta, to give, actually means when you give someone, when you're so happy with them because of their obedience. That's one of the meanings of i'ta, from ita'a. Because of the ita'a, you give i'ta. In other words, when Allah says a'tainaka, Allah is pleased with the way the messenger follows the commandments of Allah, and as a result of his pleasure, he is giving. And this is not a giving that was expected. Very important. You know, sometimes you obey someone and then they give you, like your job. You obey your boss and then you get a paycheck at the end of the week. That's ajr. That's not i'ta. I'ta is you did this because you didn't, not with any expectation. And then out of the pleasure of the one who you did it for is so pleased with you, they give you without your expectation and beyond your expectation. This is one. Then i'ta is more grand. It's not used for small things, it's only used for big things. It's not a small thing, it's a very, very big thing. Then finally, the third, that i'ta, this word is actually considered a favor that cannot be compared with. And it's something that's not taken back, and something that doesn't come with strings that are attached. In other words, once it's given to you, enjoy. Enjoy. This is something for you to enjoy. There are no strings attached with it. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Al-Kawthar, enjoy these gifts. Enjoy these gifts. And these are not gifts that I will take away from you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are parts of the meanings of i'ta. Then as far as the tense of the word is concerned, a'tayna, Allah didn't say inna sanu'ti. Like in another ayah we find inna sanulqi alayka qawlan thaqila. Sanulqi, that's the present future. That's actually the future tense. We will soon give you. But here he says inna a'tayna, no doubt we already gave you. Past tense. Now the way we think of past tense in ancient Arabic, in the Quran's Arabic, and the Arabic of those times, and the way we think of past tense in English, or in Spanish, or in German, they're different. There are some differences. I'm going to list those differences. Obviously, you already know the difference between past tense and present tense. But then why is the past tense being used for one, and a few of these gifts, Allah hasn't even given His Messenger yet, like Al-Hawd fi Jannah, even though the Messenger in one hadith says, Wallahi la anzuru ilayha. I swear by Allah, I can see it. I swear by Allah, I can see it. He told his companions, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, and we'll look at that narration too. But nonetheless, this is something in the future. So why use the past tense to talk about something in the future? This is a legitimate question. The ancient Arabs would talk about something, you know, they had certain philosophies associated with tenses. The past is for sure. Yesterday was guaranteed. But tomorrow is not guaranteed. Right, so the guarantees are associated with the past, and you know, uncertainty is associated with the future. If you want to talk about something in the future that is super guaranteed, super, there's no doubt about it, it's guaranteed it's going to happen, then you talk, and you're so sure about it, then you talk about it in the past tense, because the past tense is used to describe that which is guaranteed. It is as though you're saying, it is as sure as yesterday. It is as sure as yesterday. Okay, you know the way they say in English expression, as sure as the sun rising tomorrow. But actually we don't use that in Islam, because we're not sure if the sun's rising tomorrow. But there is a certainty associated with the past. So this is one of the rhetorical benefits of a'tayna. Allah is guaranteeing it as guaranteed as that. You know, actually there is an English expression that captures it. You know how they say done deal, right? I'll see you next week, and you say done. It's not done. It's going to be done next week. But you're saying, even psychologically, it is as guaranteed as it already happened. It's already done. Don't worry about it. Finished. It's not finished, but you're saying finished. You know? So this is the first rhetorical benefit. The second rhetorical benefit of using the past tense is the form of completion. In other words, in Arabic, present tenses are used to describe something that's not done yet. In other words, if I say أتعلم العربية, I learn Arabic. You know what that implies? I haven't finished learning yet. It's not done yet. It's still going on. But if I say to you, I learned Arabic, you know what that signifies? It's done. It's complete. As far as Allah is concerned, the favor is guaranteed, and the favor is also complete. The favor is also complete. It's not going to be shortchanged. Both implications are present in just the tense that Allah Azza wa Jal used in inna a'tainaka. Now we come to the word, I'm skipping inna for later on inshallah ta'ala. Now we come to the word kawthar. By the way, salah here is 8:30, right? So we'll wrap it up about maybe 7 minutes before Salah, and then reconvene right after Salah, inshallah. Anyhow, now we come to the word Kawthar. Kawthar, from a morphology, from a sarf point of view, belongs to the Arabic pattern Thaw'al. Thaw'al. And this word, this pattern is used for, is one of the siyagh, one of the patterns of what's called in English hyperbole, and in Arabic we call it sighatul mubalagha. Mubalagha. Now, I know I've talked about this before, but I want to, this is a newer audience, so I want to make sure you guys understand. We have to get better at English too sometimes. There's a difference between saying you hyperbolized your statement. I know a lot of you don't know what that means. I'll explain it. You hyperbolized your statement as opposed to saying you exaggerated your statement. There's a difference between hyperbolizing and exaggerating. Hyperbole means to say something in a very powerful way, in a very strong way. Exaggeration means to go beyond the truth and enter the realm of falsehood. So exaggeration is actually, you didn't exactly speak the truth. But if you hyperbolized, you were very excited, but you didn't go overboard. In other words, you didn't leave truth and enter into falsehood. I'll give you an example. Some, you know, two kids got in a fight in the parking lot, let's just say, right? And so we're getting different versions of it. Some kid walks in, there's a fight in the parking lot, a really bad one. Okay, this is hyperbole, because it's true. Even though he's excited and he elevated the speech and he made it seem like a big deal, there's truth in it. But somebody, some other kid walks in, oh my God, one of them's going to be in the hospital, it's going to be so, and they're going on and on and on. No, he just slapped him, he didn't do anything else. No hospitals are involved. This is considered what now? Exaggeration. The Quran does not have what? There's no exaggeration, but there is a lot of what? Hyperbole. There's a lot of mubalagha, there's a lot of hyperbole, but there's no exaggeration. Because the Quran, you know, قَوْلُهُ الْحَقِّ, his word is true, it's the truth. So there's no such thing as exaggeration in the Quran. Sometimes because of a lack of sensitivity even to English language, a lot of times a speaker or translator even might end up saying, oh, this is the exaggerated form. Or this is an exaggeration. It's not an exaggeration. It's a hyperbolized. That's the word to use. To empower a word in its meaning. To give a word steroids, as we say nowadays, right? To give it juice. To give it strength. To muscle it up. That's what that means. Anyhow, now this word al-kawthar. It comes from the word kathir or kathra. Kathra means to have plenty. Kathir is an adjective. Al-kawthar is incredible amounts of something. Lots and lots and lots and lots. Then you don't call it kathir, you call it Kawthar. Allah says, I have given you lots and lots and lots and lots and lots. And I can keep adding because it's Kawthar. Kawthar has a wow in it. Kathir has a ya in it. In Arabic rhetoric, in balagha, the wow is stronger than the ya. So if Allah said kathir, it would be a lot still, but Allah said Kawthar, making it even more. The word kathir in and of itself means a lot, but Allah made that word a lot times another lot because of the wow in al-Kawthar. Subhanallah. This is to describe what Allah has given His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Again, al-khayr al-kathir, fa'al min al-kathra. Similarly, al-Qurtubi comments, al-nawfal min al-nafl, other words that are hyperbolized in the same way. Al-jawhar min al-jahr. Wal-Arab tusammi kulla shay'in kathir fil-adad wal-qadr wal-khitr kawtharan. And the Arabs used to mention, talk about anything that is a lot in terms of its quantity, a lot in terms of its value, a lot in terms of you having to want to protect it and guard it. Those kinds of words, they used to call them kawthar. Something that was, there was a lot of it, and it was very, very valuable, then they would use that word. فَالْكَوْثَرْ هُوَ بِالْإِضَافَةِ إِلَى الْكَثْرَةِ الْمُفَرَّةَةِ فَهُوَ فِي الْخَيْرِ خُصُوصًا. This is also important. When you say a lot of something, is it possible it's a lot of good things or a lot of bad things or a lot of mixed? It's possible. Because when you say a lot, I gave you a lot. Right? Or I taught you a lot. Maybe I taught you a lot of good things and also in there some bad things. The word kathir can be used for good and bad things. But the word kawthar can only be used for good things. It's mutakhassis, or mutakhassas rather. It's specialized and specifically used only in context of that which is good. This is part of the perfection of the ayah. That Allah said, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ. In other words, everything Allah has given him is incredibly good. And he's given him a lot of it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَعِنْدَمَا عُرِفَ الْكَوْثَرِ بِالتَّعْرِيفِ. This is also important. There's an al on it. إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرِ. الْكَوْثَرِ. Now, one of the features of Arabic is when you say, إِنَّا أَعْطَيْنَاكَ كَوْثَرًا. كَوْثَرًا. That can refer to many different things. But if you put al on something, one of the implications of that is it's only referring to one thing. So some have argued because this is Al-Kawthar, it's only referring to the river in paradise and nothing else. And the proof of that is the Al. They're saying that the Al is proof that it can only be referring to one thing, and that one thing can only be what we find in the Athar, which is Al-Hawd fil Jannah or Al-Hawd fil Mawqif, right? That's the only thing it can be referring to. But وَلَوْ قَالَ كَوْثَرْ لَمَّا دَخَلَ النَّهَرْ فِيهِ لَكِنَّ الْحَذْفِ الْمَوْصُوفِ. This is the comment. لَكِنَّ حَذْفَ الْمَوْصُوفِ أَفَادَ الْإِطْلَاقِ وَجَمَعَ كُلَّ خَيْرٍ. When you refer in Arabic to something with an adjective, you know how in English we have nouns and adjectives, right? When you talk about the adjective but you don't mention the noun, right? Then that adjective could be referring to many things, even if it has al. Allah, by saying a lot, or a great many, plenty, are these words nouns or adjectives? Plenty, lots. These are adjectives. And if because the Allah used an adjective and didn't quantify a noun, didn't specify what noun is it an adjective of, Al-Hawd al-Kathir, Al-Hawd al-Kawthar, he didn't mention the noun. By not mentioning the noun, it opens the scope and the acceptability of other possibilities in the ayah. And this is part of the grand gift giving of Allah Azza wa Jal, that he didn't limit the gift that he gave to his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just give you a couple more references as far as the linguistics of the word Kawthar. There's a poetry about the old woman in Arabic history, who, you know, her son went to travel, and the Arab son would go to travel to, you know, go and trade and bring back wealth. So he comes back, and the mother is asked, Bima ababnuk, what did your son bring? What did he come back with? And what does she respond? Bi kawtharin. He came back with kawthar. Ay, meaning bimalin kathir. He came back with a lot of wealth. He made good money on that trip. So she's first of all delighted because her son is back, and she's really happy because he came back loaded, right? So that's where the word kawthar is used even before Islam. This is the shi'r. Wa anta kathirun yabna marwana tayyibun. And you are a lot, you are very good in terms of your good character, Ibn Marwan. So the poet is praising a guy named Ibn Marwan. But then he says, your dad was awesome. You're okay, but your dad, man, he was just awesome. So what does he say about him? وَكَانَ أَبُوكَ إِبْنُ الْعَقَائِلِ كَوْثَرًا. But your dad, Ibn al-Aqail, that guy was kawthar. You're tayyib, you're good. But that guy, he was amazed, he was kawthar. So what he's saying is, you should be more like your dad. I'm impressed, but I'm not that impressed. You know, and the way he does that, he compares the word tayyib with the word kawthar, meaning he was really very, very, very good. The final comment, inshallah ta'ala, in regards to Al-Kawthar, actually we'll do two more things, we have time. I think I can pull them in there, inshallah. The word inna, we didn't do that. We did a'tainaka, we did Al-Kawthar, but we didn't do inna. This inna in Arabic is actually grammatically, even if you don't say it, the sentence is complete. You can say a'tainaka Al-Kawthar. We gave you Al-Kawthar. It's still a complete sentence. And the word we is already there, because at the word of a'tay you have the na, that's the fa'il, that's the word we. It's already there. But we say inna, that's a we, na at the end. A'tayna, that's another we. Now if you literally translate, certainly we, comma, we gave you al-kawthar. This is the literal translation. And this is actually what the Arabs are meaning by it. Now let me give you some context. When does somebody mention themselves twice in terms of an act that they did? For example, you know, there's an argument or something. I paid for it. You understand what I just did? Me, I hired you. I mentioned myself twice. Why? This is a means by which I am reminding someone of something they can clearly forget. This is one thing. Second, this is a case of ihtimam, it's called in Arabic. To highlight something, to give importance to something. And here Allah Azza wa Jalla is giving importance to the giving. I am the one who gave. I gave. No doubt about it. The word inna is also important. You could also say nahnu a'tainaka al-kawthar. But there's inna, the harf al-tawqeed is there. The benefit of harf al-tawqeed is to remove doubt. This is by most accounts a Makki surah, even though there are respectable narrations, even in Muslim, even in Sahih Muslim, that this could be a Madani surah. But we'll reconcile those two by the end of this dars, inshallah ta'ala. How do we understand when there are multiple narrations? Some say the surah is Makki, others say the surah is Madani, especially such a short surah, which we assume the whole surah came down at once. then how can there be differences of opinion about when the surah came down? We'll understand why those differences exist and how to reconcile those differences, inshallah ta'ala. This is a good opportunity to do that. This surah is a good opportunity to do that. But nonetheless, the word inna here, removing doubt, if you understand that this surah is Makki, which is the ijma' of the ummah, by the way, the ijma' pretty much is on the fact that it's Makki. And that's how you'll find it ascribed in the Mus'haf also. Then you understand that the Messenger والسلام, is dealing with a group of people that are very insulting and condescending and hurtful. And they're constantly making mention of what the Messenger doesn't have. What he doesn't have. Even at the end of this surah, you know Abu Lahab? He was the Prophet's neighbor. La'anahu Allah, he was the Prophet's neighbor. And the first son of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Qasim radiallahu anhu, he passed away. There was still one son left. What's his name? Abdullah radiallahu anhu. Besides the four daughters, right? And these are all, you know, and Abdullah is left. And then one day the news comes out that Abdullah radiallahu anhu has also passed away. And one of the first people to get the news, you know who it was? It was Abu Lahab. And he's happy like anything. You know, what kind of disgusting person could be happy at the death of a child? Even your enemy, if their child dies, you get a soft corner in your heart. How filthy can this person be? How cut off from their humanity can they be? That he's celebrating this, he goes dancing out of his house, goes and announces, oh, Muhammad, his name's going to be cut off. You know, Batara Muhammadun. His lineage is done, he's finished. No more sons for him. In other words, they would boast about what the Prophet doesn't have. They would also talk about the Prophet's lack of wealth, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They would talk about the Prophet's lack of backing. In other words, he's an orphan, right? How come this Qur'an wasn't given, عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرِيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ? How come it wasn't given to one of the leaders of the tribe, of the two tribes? How come we have to listen to him? They would constantly make mention of what the Messenger doesn't have. And Allah begins the surah by saying, no, don't worry about what you don't have. I've given you plenty. We, no doubt about it. Don't doubt it ever. Do not doubt it ever. And let no one who hears this ever doubt that you have been given more than they can ever imagine. Al-Kawthar. And we have granted it to you. No strings attached. And we've given you lots and lots and lots of it. Unimaginable amounts of it. Subhanallah. How the ayah contrasts what's in the beginning to what's at the end. And how it comes to the consolation of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, when somebody speaks in a bad way to you, then you need somebody to calm you down and say, it's okay, don't worry about it, you know, don't let it get to you. And even if you know those things, when you hear them from someone else, you say, yeah, you're right, man, thanks. You helped me calm down. Who comes to calm the Messenger down? Who comes to the consolation of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Allah does in the Qur'an. This is one of the gifts of Allah to the Messenger. He comes to the aid of His Messenger. Allah knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala, when His Messenger is feeling sad, when he feels insulted, when he feels hurt by the words that they say. وَلَقَدْ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُ يَضِيقُ صَدْرُكَ بِمَا يَقُولُونَ. We know already that your chest becomes tight because of the things they say. You don't think the Messenger's chest would become tight? Your child just dies and somebody's celebrating that? Somebody, I mean, imagine that. I mean, leave the fact aside that he's the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Any human being, that you would see somebody celebrating the death of your child. How much kind of rage and pain would it cause you? And then after that, what does he have to do? He has to go and make da'wah to the same people and be patient with them. He can't go into battle with them. He doesn't do, not yet, no. Patiently make da'wah to them. وَاصْبِرْ عَلَىٰ مَا يَقُولُونَ. Be patient with what they're saying. We pass over those ayat so easily. Be patient with what they're saying. Can you realize what they're saying? Do you realize what, I mean, imagine somebody said this kind of thing to you. You'd lose it. You would lose it. You say, he said, you don't know what he said. That's what you'll say. You'll act crazy. And when I try to stop you, you'll say, you don't know what he said, man. Well, we know what he said. But look at the sunnah of this man, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we call our messenger. What an amazing role model Allah has given us in terms of his patience. And what kind of heart it takes to make da'wah to people like that. To know that this despicable human being, and on top of that, he's family. And this tells you another lesson. The most hurtful words will come from where? The family. Your own family can say the nastiest things because they know they can get it. It's all family, it's all good. They can say it and get away with it. Oh, what's the matter? He's getting under your skin? You know, and they'll keep poking because it's all good in the hood. You know, it's all good. If somebody else said it to you outside, you break into a fight. Let your uncle go off on you all day. Right? So, like the Messenger's uncle, no exception. Right? In this case, لَعَنَهُ اللَّهُ. Anyhow, let's finish this comment and we break for the salah. يُوجَدْ الْأَمْرَانِ. In inna, in the ayah, there are two issues found. Al-ikhtisas, exclusivity, meaning it is only we who have given you Kawthar. And since it is only we who has given it to you, the only one who can take it away is us. But since we gave you i'ta, not ita, we're never going to take it away either. No one can take away from you what we have given you. They can take whatever, they think they're taking something away from you. They've got nothing. Inna a'tainaka. This is al-ikhtisas. The second is fal-ihtimam. And Allah has given high importance to the giving that Allah gives His Messenger. This is called ihtimam. Hamma shay. Ahamma shay. He gave it importance. So this gift that Allah has given His Messenger with this tawqeed on inna in the beginning is a special, you know, privilege has been given to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We just count from a language point of view how many ways Allah has magnified what He's giving His Messenger in just the first ayah. And we're just at a loss. And the gifts Allah gives His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Inshallah ta'ala, after the break, immediately after Isha, I'll try and wrap up the first session on Surah Al-Kawthar. I don't think we're going to finish Surah Al-Kawthar today, but I hope to finish at least the commentary on the first ayah. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ni wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.